Hallelujah. It says, now it happened as we went to prayer that a certain slave girl possessed with a spirit of divination met us, who brought her masters much profit by fortune telling. And this girl followed Paul and us and cried out, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God who proclaim to us the way of salvation. And this she did for many days, but Paul, greatly annoyed, turned and said to the spirit, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out that very hour. But when her masters saw that their hope of profit was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace to the authorities. Go to the next slide for me. And they brought them to the magistrates and said, these men, being Jews, exceedingly trouble our city. And they teach customs which are not lawful for us, being Romans, to receive or observe. And then the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates tore off their clothes and commanded them to be beaten with rods. And when they had laid many stripes on them, they threw them into prison, commanding the jailer to keep them securely. Having received such a charge, he put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks. But at midnight... Some of y'all must not ever had no midnight moments.
Come on.
I didn't hear nothing.
Come on.
But at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. Looks a little familiar.
Yes.
And the prisoners were listening to them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were loosed. And the keeper of the prison, awakened from sleep and seeing the prison doors open, supposing the prisoners had fled, drew his sword and was about to kill himself. But Paul called with a loud voice, saying, do yourself no harm, for we are all here.
Yes.
And then he called for a light, ran in and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. And he brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes.
You and your household. And then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and all who were in his house. God, thank you.
Yes.
Let me ask you, you begin to read this passage in Acts chapter 16. It says, we went to prayer. And as we were going, essentially not just to prayer, but they were going to worship. And as they were heading to seek out God and seek out what God had for their life, they were being trailed. They were being chased by hell. I'm curious if you've run through 2016 feeling like you've been chased by hell. I realize that there are moments that certainly God has blessed us. God has done things. God has shown himself. God has spoken to us. But I think for so many people, and even including myself, we would feel like that the path that we walked in 2016, even though it was in pursuit of maybe the right things or it was in pursuit of God, we felt oftentimes like we were being trailed by hell.
Yeah.
And I'm encouraged when I read this passage because, you know, Paul's a pretty cool dude, you know. And Paul's got his junk together. And God decided to use Paul in an amazing way. And if Paul himself is being chased by hell, it gives me confidence to know then if it's after me, then something's up. You with me? I mean, I'm just being transparent. I won't necessarily go into everything, but even the last 48 hours for me, I'm talking about it. I feel like it's trying to just come right on into 2017 with me. It's hanging on by the coattails. I mean, it's just tried its best to jump on me and come after me in a way to just, you know, it's just a matter of being discouraged. Sometimes we get locked up in places to where we operate in bad behaviors or we revert to old ways or old sins. But sometimes it's just a matter of trying to train your mind in a way of bad thinking. It's just sometimes after your thought processes. Maybe you got your junk worked out. Maybe you're past this thing to where, you know what, I ain't an addict no more. I ain't drunk no more. I ain't running around on nobody no more. But it's still after my mind. It's still trying to change my thoughts and challenge my thoughts. And that's exactly. I mean, it will use anything. You follow me?
Yep.
It will use anything. It will use anybody. It just happened to manifest through my 9-year-old and my 6-year-old in the last 48 hours.
All right. I have no idea.
No sleep, just frustrated, knowing we coming in here, got to speak at midnight almost, and just ain't slept in 2 days, I don't think. And my kids is just driving me crazy and just everything. I've been mad, frustrated, angry. You know, just my house just feeling like it's in disarray. You with me?
Yeah.
Both of us, we love God. My children love God. I love my children, but sometimes it just tries to find its way to chase you wherever it can get you. You with me? I mean, it's chasing me, man. It's chasing me. But, you know, the thing that I like about this is that it's chasing me because it has this understanding of what's locked inside of me. I'm going to tell you, if you're not being challenged in your thought processes, you with me? If your mind isn't being challenged or chased by hell, you really need to evaluate who you are. I'm just chilling out tonight. I'm going to encourage you a little bit. Hopefully my gear may kick in a little bit, but it says it happened as we went to worship God that a certain slave girl that was possessed with a spirit of divination. Man, I have preached this passage so many times, and I love this particular passage here because the spirit of divination, what this actually is called is the spirit of Python.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Python is an aggressor. A python is an aggressor, and it attacks its enemy, but it does not chew its enemy or create harm or pain by its fangs. A python sucks the life out of you.
Yes.
You with me?
Come on.
Python sucks the life out of you. And so here's Paul and Silas encouraged, being sent by God, knowing that they're anointed by God, that they're gifted by God, equipped by God, and have got a message of life by God. And they're met face to face with something that wants to suck the life out of them. They enter a territory that patterns the picture of the spirit of Python, because in this territory here, this in Philippi here, where it's ruled by this Roman government, it looks like everything is going well. It looks like the pattern of life is really successful, when in reality, it has had the life sucked out of it.
Come on, baby.
This territory has been put literally under the spell of this spirit that has possessed this girl, the spirit of divination that come upon and met Paul and Silas. And it says she brought her masters much profit by fortune telling. Let me hang out right here for just a second. It says, the girl followed Paul and us and cried out, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God who proclaim the way to salvation to us. The enemy literally will come and trail you to create an environment of deception within you, mm-hmm. that it can manipulate your thought processes. Maybe you've got your gear in order. Maybe you've got your practices, your daily routine in order. But a spirit will trail you that will attempt to manipulate the thought processes of your mind.
Yeah.
And begin to work on this picture that you have of yourself and your environment and your identity. Because, like I said, it says it had a spirit of divination, which means fortune telling. Mm. It had foreknowledge of who these men were. And because it had foreknowledge of who these men were and what God was trying to do, the devil knows exactly what God is up to. You follow me? You know what's so good about God is that he's so powerful that even the enemy knows who he is and what he's doing and still can't stop him. Okay? And so the enemy knows exactly what God is up to, knows the understanding or the identity of these individuals, and tries to run ahead of these two men to create a separate understanding or a separate identity that literally will take them out of place of truth to where it can begin to manipulate their processes in the order of this territory. The enemy will chase you, telling you a different story than what God has ever said.
Come on.
Let me ask this. I began to talk Wednesday night about promises and seeds. How many of you have heard something from God? God, that you know that God has put in you to do, that God has equipped you to do, gifted you to do, that He's planned for you to do, purpose for you to do, whatever it may be. How many of you have heard God talk to you and give you an understanding or a promise that He wants to see come to pass in your life, and yet you've literally lived life feeling like hell has trailed you and you have not seen that manifest yet? And you have begun to wonder as you've walked through that pattern of life, thinking that you're chasing the promise of God, that this spirit of divination has begun to convince you of something different. Are you with me? That it's begun to challenge your thinking, even your own picture of your own identity of yourself. It has a way of trying to manipulate the environment, manipulate the resource, manipulate so that it can literally set the order of your environment to look like you're living in a way that's pleasing or productive, when in reality you're going through a routine that has no life.
Right. Say it. Right.
That's
good.
God sent these two men into a culture, literally, man, that was extremely successful according to culture standards, but it had no life. Y'all gonna have to let me break for a minute. I'm gonna pause right here. I'm gonna show you something in a few minutes. When God sent me to Anderson, I'm just gonna talk to you for a minute. We'll get away from this. When God sent me to Anderson, you guys have heard this before, that two of the things that God really challenged me that we were after here was breaking down the spirit or this covering of racism in this territory, that we were gonna create a place of diversity where people of all, not just colors, but all different kinds of backgrounds, socioeconomic status, education levels, whatever it may be, could be in a place in one accord, in one mind, challenging the territories of the enemy for the kingdom of God. The other thing that God really spoke to me about is that Anderson, and whether you believe this or not, and if you're mad at me because I'm talking about your area, you can just gonna have to deal with it. Anderson deals with a poverty mindset.
Right.
Now follow me. I'm not just talking about money.
Right.
It ain't got nothing to do with money.
Right.
It's got everything to do with the hope in your thoughts.
That's right.
It's got everything to do with what you believe can happen in and through your life, in and through your territory, in and through your family. And we literally live in a community here that had been sucked the life out of it by the spirit of divination, so that it looks like everything is going well, but there's really no production in it.
That's good.
You with me?
Yeah.
Two things that God, we're going to break down the walls of racism, and we're going to bring hope or life back to a place that literally has had the life sucked out of it. And you know what's funny? I'm just telling stories right now. I ain't even preaching to you. What's so funny about this is that when God confirmed in me that this is where we were going to come and plant a church, I was running down the road and I was listening to a song by Fred Hammond called "We're Blessed in This City." Who knows that song? "We're Blessed in This City." Now, see, there's a portion of that song that when they kind of break a little bit and the woman gets on them against to read scripture, and the scripture she reads is Acts 16. Right? She says, and the Bible says, and at midnight, Paul and Silas began to pray and sing praises unto God. And I was listening to that song when God confirmed in me that this is where we were coming. And as I'm studying this thing the other day, God really awakened to me that said, Jason, this is literally Anderson that I've sent you to. Philippi and Anderson look a lot alike. Because here, let me just show you something really quick. Let me see. I'm way off. I'm just talking to y'all right now. Y'all just be patient with me, okay? We got an hour till midnight. Just be patient. Go to the next slide. I just want to show you something for a minute. Go to the next slide. Watch. I just want to show you. It says, and they brought them to the magistrates. After they were arrested, they brought them to the magistrates. These people are frustrated. They're angry at these two men. Brought them to the magistrates, and watch what the first thing that they say. These men, being Jews. What's that? Come on now. These men being Jews. These men being different than us. We don't want them here because they don't look like us. We don't want them here because they don't think like us. We don't want them because they don't come from the same territory or the same bloodline that I come from. These men being Jews exceedingly trouble our city. God began to say, there's some racism right there. Okay? I might just be talking to myself tonight. But I might not, I may be working this thing out in this new year with me. And then it says, and they teach customs which are not lawful for us. Watch. For us being Romans to receive or observe. Now, you got to read between the lines and begin to look at this a little bit. What the problem is here is that they're telling them that these guys have come in to establish a new order and a new authority. And if we let them come in and establish a new order and authority, we can't manipulate the environment and control the territory. Right now, we control the money. Right now, we control the commerce. Right now, we control the relationships. Right now, we control the business. Right now, we control the families. And if we let a different bloodline or a different order come in here, it will have life given to it and a life that we cannot manipulate. You follow me? So, racism and a poverty mindset. God was just, he's like, Jason, this is it.
That's all right.
And then I began to look, and I'm like, God, the last 2 days I have had hell chasing me. And I know you've had hell chasing you. I know you've had hell chasing you. If you've been a part of this thing that we're trying to do here, you've had hell chasing you. I'm just telling you. But I want to just encourage you tonight because things are about to get so much different.
Amen. Come on, say it.
Go backwards for me again. Let me start over. Let me go back here and just talk about it a little bit more. So this girl followed us and was trying to create a different understanding, a different belief system about yourself through deception. It does not capture your true identity. The enemy's trying to trail you because he understands your identity greater than you understand it for yourself. And because he has this spirit of divination or the ability to fortune tell the forecoming of your life, see, he knows what the seed is inside of you. He knows what God is trying to manifest through you. He knows what God has put inside of you. He knows what's ahead for himself, and therefore he knows it's coming through you. If God is going to establish anything on earth, it's going to happen through man, and so he's afraid of what's about to be birthed out of you, and so he will chase you, and he will chase you trying to establish a different identity through deception and manipulation than you can even see about yourself. And what he's trying to do is he's trying to establish his authority of order in your own life so that the order of God never comes out of your life and begins to change the environment that you're involved in. He will establish and keep reign over the culture one person at a time, chasing each person, sending the demonic to each person's house, each person's job, each person's family, each person's marriage, and in order to chase after their mind to keep you from seeing the truth about what God is trying to do inside of you and declaring something different about you that you begin to believe in. And as you believe it, life cannot be birthed out of what you suppress. Are you with me? So this girl followed Paul and us, crying out, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God who proclaim to us the way of salvation. The devil knew what they were there for.
Yes.
The devil knew that they were there to change the game. And it says she did this for many days, greatly annoying Paul and Silas. See, some of y'all pass getting drunk, but you ain't pass getting frustrated.
Amen.
Yes.
Ain't nobody like that. See, some of y'all ain't got issues no more looking at the pornography, but you get annoyed about it every day. Can I tell you, it ain't a whole lot different? Because if he can chase after you and get you annoyed, it will retrain your thought processes. And that annoyance will begin to take over. And the frustration will begin to set in. And a different picture of who you really are will begin to come out than what God has established for your life. And you'll begin operating out of frustration. And you'll begin operating out of being annoyed. And you'll begin to operate out of being angered. And you'll begin to operate out of having no life inside of you whatsoever. He'll keep after that every single day just to frustrate you.
Yes. Tell it.
Retraining the thought processes of your life. Why? Because he does not have the authority to change it himself. So through my spirit of divination, because I already know what you're capable of, I'm going to slide something different to you.
Yes.
so that if I just follow you long enough, I will literally walk you into a different place than God ever intended for you to go. And she did it for many days. She began to frustrate the thought processes just as she, you got to see that what she is trying to establish in Paul and Silas has already been established in the territory. She's captured the minds and or this spirit has captured the minds and the hearts and the operation and the thinking and the principles of everybody living in this culture, or else they wouldn't be bothered by these two men that have been sent by a different order coming into their territory. It's not the enemy. I mean, it's not these men speaking when they're saying, you know what, they're going to disrupt our culture. It's the enemy talking about, you know what, I can't let them here. I can't let them in this environment because I have already created a foothold over it, and it's mine. Yeah. And as long as I can possess it, I can keep whatever God wants to do out of this place, because it will only happen through man. She did it for many days, frustrating them, chased them, having an understanding of what's to come. And the truth is that he's not really afraid of your present. He's afraid of your potential.
That's right.
And so until you reach a place that you have maximized the potential of your life, he will always chase you.
That's right.
Are you with me?
Yeah.
He will always chase you.
That's right.
He will always chase you because he's after the power. He's after the power. He wants to manipulate the power with a different mentality. He's after what he can't have. And so he will use you to get it. So I will chase you, and I will annoy you, and I will frustrate you, and I will put things in your mind, and I will walk you in certain paths, and I will carry you to a place of darkness. And I'll use what's in you to create my own authority.
Great job. Great job.
Y'all with me?
Yeah.
Come on, man.
See, this is that play. We like to talk about just sin, you know, whatever we categorize as sin. When the reality is if we're not aligning our mind with the order of God and operating through the principles of his life to see the potential come out of us, that we don't begin to shape the culture around us for his kingdom, we're living no different than anybody that's strung out, doped up, broke, whatever it may be. See, God, let me just give you a little education for a minute that we have miscommunicated in our Christian culture today. It ain't about getting out of hell.
That's right.
Sin was never a part of your existence. It was never intended to be a part of your makeup.
That's right.
And so it's not about trying to get you out of sin. It's trying to get the kingdom in you and through you and out of you. It's trying to get the purpose of God, the image of God out of your life, because literally that's how he creates his territory expansion, is through your life and through the authority and dominion of your life. Sin ain't got nothing to do with this thing. And so if I just get to this place that I try to push away my mistakes, but I don't ever lock into the potential of God in my life, I'm still living for the enemy. Y'all don't remember when he says there'll be many that say, Lord, Lord?
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. Did we not cast out devils in your name?
That's right.
Jesus. Right?
Amen.
The problem is they had pushed sin out, but they hadn't developed his image. Just a little free note right there. See, your potential, this whole image thing brings out this new order. This new order of God that will restore and renew life in a lifeless culture. I am all about seeing people live. We have gotten locked in. I'm going to kill church culture again. We have gotten so locked in with eternal life that we don't even understand what eternal life is.
That's right.
We have gotten so locked in to the hereafter that we don't realize that God established us in the present. Are you with me? Eternal life has absolutely nothing to do when your eyes go to sleep and you wake up in a celestial being. Has absolutely nothing to do. Eternal life happens when you embrace the embody the Almighty, ever-living God.
Yeah.
Eternal life happens at the moment that you begin to transform yourself into his image. That's eternal life. You can walk right now, never die a day, and live eternally with inside the presence of God. Are you with me?
Yeah.
And so it's afraid. This enemy is afraid of that eternal life that's inside of you. The enemy's afraid of this potential that's inside of you getting out, because it will establish a new order in your environment. It will. It won't matter. You don't have to know the right things to declare and speak. You just begin to transform self. You just begin to let the principles of God overcome self. You begin to get confident in what God has established in you. If you can live that thing out and not listen to those voices, if you can let hell chase you all day long and it not move you, you condition your environment for the kingdom of God. That's good. See, the enemy wants to create control over your understanding and the potential of self because he's attempting to control every resource that God has established for you. Mm-hmm. See, we see a culture in Philippi here to where the people got mad because this girl was making her money. Mm-hmm. The enemy was making her money. Mm-hmm. The enemy got mad because God had stepped in and decided, you know what, you can't control the resources of this environment anymore. Everything that the righteous, that the wicked uses is stored up for the righteous. Yes. Everything that God has established is provision for purpose that the enemy is trying to manipulate. The resources of your life that God has given you because he intends to use it to expand the kingdom in you. If the enemy can lock into your mind, he'll never touch a dollar bill, but he'll manipulate and control everywhere it goes by your thinking.
Right.
You with me?
Yeah.
And so he will chase you, not running after your stuff, but running after your thinking.
Yeah, I think so.
He will chase after your perception of self, your perception of your environment, of your circumstances. If he can work to get you aggravated, man, that's exactly what he'll attempt to do because he can push you anywhere he wants you to go. Let me just see what I can go over here. This whole thing, it says she did this for many days, and Paul, greatly annoyed, in turn and said to the Spirit, I command you, come out. And when the master saw that their hope for profit was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace to the authorities. Go to the next slide. And they brought them to the magistrates and said, these men, being Jews, exceedingly trouble our city. They teach customs which are not lawful, being Romans to receive or observe. Then the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates tore off their clothes and commanded them to be beaten with rods. Let me just tell you this. Encourage you to keep moving, to keep stepping, to keep seeking God, to keep running after that place of meeting him, that place of prayer and that place of worship, because the enemy's passion is to get you to a place that he can chase you to where he beats you into submission.
Mm. Oh my
Jesus.
God.
All right. Mm-hmm. I ain't getting real keyed up tonight. I'm just talking to you. He wants to get to a place that literally he's chasing after you, and he's drilling you, and he's telling you, and he's talking to you, and he's sending people around you to talk to you, and he's putting people in your path. Mm-hmm. To manipulate you. Mm-hmm. And he's sending people in your lineage to deceive you. Mm-hmm. And all the while, you know, it ain't that big a deal because I know this one, I know that one, but the enemy's working and manipulating. Mm-hmm. Trying to drive you to a place that essentially he beats you into a place of submission.
Oh, that's right.
That you no longer have the hope for what God is trying to establish in your life, or you lock into the fact that you feel like you've already arrived at it and you quit pursuing it. And the whole idea is that he strips you naked and embarrasses you. Mm-hmm. Because he controls you.
That's right.
And when they laid many stripes on them, they threw them into the prison, commanding the jailer to keep them securely. Having received such a charge, he put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet into stocks. The inner prison is a place that was reserved for the most hardened criminals, those that had done the most dirt, those that were an embarrassment to society, those that society cared not to see anymore. It was the deepest of the darkest. There were no, the stench of dead flesh and rotting humans just corroded the environment there because they locked them in and left them. And There are no windows, there's no light, there's no air, there's no room to breathe. It's just a suffocating place of death. It's a place of absolute darkness.
Yeah.
A place where, you ever been in a place where it just is so dark that you don't, you ever been to maybe like a haunted house or to a place that you didn't have any familiarity with as far as with its surroundings, that you didn't know where to go next, that you're feeling your way around and you only got thoughts going through your mind about, am I supposed to step here or do I turn here or what do? I stop? Do I listen? What do I do? I don't know how to get to where I'm going. It's just so dark that I don't know what to expect. This place, and that this place was so enveloped with darkness that you couldn't see the man next to you. And it's exactly where the enemy is attempting to drive your thought processes. It's to a place of darkness that you don't know what to do next. It's to a place of darkness that you don't even know what to think about yourself next.
Jesus.
You don't know where to go. We'll get to such a place of darkness that we don't even know what to pray.
Amen.
That's right.
You say it.
That's right.
And the problem about it is that sometimes in that place of darkness is that our senses of hearing awaken in a place of darkness because we cannot see. You with me?
That's right.
So you ever met a blind person? They couldn't see, but man, they just listened for everything and they could hear, and it was just such a keen sense because their hearing sense had just so awakened and heightened because they could not see that this just so manifested they could hear everything around them. When we're in a place that we don't have the ability to see what's next, we'll begin listening for what's next.
Come on.
And the danger in listening sometimes into what's next is that we give our attention of our ears to the wrong voices.
Amen.
And we'll allow some of those voices to begin to encourage us on what path to take, what route to go. And the problem is that we begin to find our own confidence and our own identity in a voice that's locked in the same darkness we are.
Mm-hmm. Right. Amen.
You with me?
Oh, yeah.
In a place of darkness where they don't know how to move, what to do, what to say, convinced that there's no tomorrow, locked in shackles and chains and these stocks and bound, literally with no possibility of escape. The doors were then shut, and the doors were shut and locked from the outside with these bars. There's just absolutely nobody even inside. The jailer's not even inside with them. He's standing on the outside on guard. And they're locked in this prison cell with no possibility of tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
And God began to talk to me about this a little bit. This whole midnight thing. Midnight is a place of transition. Anywhere in Scripture that you see midnight mentioned, it means that something is about to shift. Something is about to happen. Midnight is also the it's literally the midpoint between the dawn and the dusk.
Yes.
You with me? It's the midpoint between the close of one day and the entry into another. The way I like to look at that is it literally is shutting down one moment of my life and it's walking into a new opportunity.
Yeah.
Jesus.
Midnight represents the one of the darkest points of a day.
Yeah.
At midnight it's at its darkest point that you will see outside. The stars are shining their brightest because it's as dark as it will ever get. And it says, but at midnight, Paul and Silas began to do something that created a shift. God began to talk to me about this whole darkness thing. Go to Genesis chapter 1 really quickly for me. You know, at midnight, everything still looks the same, but something's different.
Oh my God.
At midnight, right? At midnight, you walking around your house at midnight, 11:59, and all of a sudden the clock ticks 12. The house still looks the same. It ain't got no brighter outside, right? Everything looks the same, but everything's changing. And the thing about, what's crazy about it is that we picture midnight as still being the day before. You with me?
Yeah.
We've been conditioned in our operation that unless I go to sleep and awaken to a new day, it's still yesterday. You with me?
Yeah.
And so if I'm walking through the pattern of my life and just going through my home or wherever I may be and the clock moves from 11:59 to 12, I have been conditioned in my mind that it's still yesterday. And I will still live as if it was yesterday. And unless I force myself to lay in my bed and close my eyes and awaken to something new, my thought processes have been trained that it's still yesterday. And if I'm not careful, because my thought processes have been trained that midnight is still yesterday, I'll bring into my tomorrows what I should have left in yesterday. But you know, the thing about it is that I got two children that are absolutely afraid of the dark. Blows my mind. In our own home. Like, this is your house, man. What you afraid to go downstairs for? And we, for somehow, some way, we've been conditioned to have this picture of the darkness and of the midnight as it being a very scary place.
Yes, it is.
A place of uncertainty. A place that sometimes we're afraid to go to. But if you begin to look at Genesis chapter 1, it says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form, and it was without void." So it had no order. And darkness was over the face of the deep. It had no order, and darkness was present. And God began to show me that this looks a lot like Philippi. This looks a lot like Paul and Silas's present situation. That there was no order, or at least there was no godly order. The enemies were afraid that God's order would be established, so they put them in prison.
Yes, yes.
No godly order present. An environment that looked like it was successful, but it was in chaos. And they were in the darkness. But what's so cool about Genesis chapter 1 is it says, "And God hovered over the darkness."
Yes.
Right? It says God hovered over what did not have order and what was dark.
Jesus, God.
Oh. Let me just begin to encourage you a little bit that if the enemy has tried to travel you down a road and drive you to a place of darkness,
yes,
what you need to be encouraged by is that God is still hovering there. As a matter of fact, I would almost even begin to wonder if it was really the enemy that drove me to the darkness to begin with.
Ooh, watch out. Mm-hmm. Watch out.
Because it says, "The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face, hovering over the darkness, hovering over the lack of order, his potential just covering." And something happened when he said the words, "Let there be."
No.
We tend to attempt to escape the darkness. and believe that things will change if we can escape the darkness. Are you with me? Let me try to get out of the dark places that I don't understand. Let me try to get away from the places that frustrate me. Let me try to move and escape the places that make me afraid. Let me get away from the people, the workplace, the family member, whatever it may be that is just so dark that I don't understand it. It's just so dark that I want to be around it. And God said, but I only birth out of darkness. You got to hear me. I only create anew out of what has no life.
Tell it.
Are you following me?
Yes.
He says, and there it was, when I desired to expand my territory, that I had to walk into a place that was dark. See, the reality is that you either have light or you have dark.
Yes.
And it'd be foolish for God to recreate himself in his present location. He said, so I got to walk to a place that has no order, a place that has no life, in order to give new birth.
Jesus.
See, God, when he was giving these ladies a womb, he was given the possibility or the potential of life in a place that had never seen life before. See, when God decided that he was going to expand your family and that seed was planted and new birth began to happen, it happened in a place that was extremely dark.
That's it.
We tend to want to run away from the dark places, and God is trying to drive us to them. What Paul and Silas give us a very great example of is that we have to learn not to be afraid of the darkness, but to relish it. Because God will drive us to dark places to birth new things out of us. But I must maintain the mind of God in the process of pursuing the darkness. The enemy will trail me. The enemy will attempt to convince me. He will chase me. He will try to embarrass me, strip me, confuse me, manipulate me, and almost make me think that he's carrying me where he wants me to go. When in reality, it's God that's driving me to the place of new birth. It wasn't midnight that created the shift. Midnight only created the opportunity. Are you following me?
Yeah.
See, let me just tell you. 2017 won't change anything. It only creates a new opportunity.
Yeah.
Are you following me? We tend to hover over this place. Go back to Acts really quickly. Go back to Acts where it says, but at midnight. We tend to hover on this place here and believe that at midnight, if I can just get to midnight, if I can just get to 2017,
yeah,
something's going to change. If I can just make it to that place where there's a shift, the problem is the shift is inside of you.
Yes, sir.
See, watch. God hovered over the darkness and said, let there be light.
Yes.
And there was light.
Yes.
What had no order, what had no form and void, all of a sudden began to take on the potential of God.
Yes.
But nothing changed unless he invited it in. He said, let there be. It's dark, it's empty, it's lifeless, but let there be life.
Yeah.
God spoke to himself and said, let there be life. I'll create a shift with life. I must get into dark places for new birth, but then I'll invite myself in. And there'll be life. But at midnight, Paul and Silas said, "Let there be light." In a place of darkness, of no form and no void, guess who was still hovering over that prison? Yes. All I'm here to tell you tonight is that God is desiring to create, as we've been talking, new birth out of you. But the only places that you'll get new birth is in a place that's never seen life. So you can't be afraid to be driven to the darkness. You can't be afraid to be driven to the people that seem like they have no hope. You can't be afraid to open up your mouth and speak to those that reject your words. You can't be afraid to go to a spouse that has turned their back on you and God. You can't be afraid to go into a workplace that will not let you declare the principles of the kingdom. You cannot be afraid to live in a community where it seems like there's no hope, because God's hovering over the darkness. Yes. And 2017 is only creating the opportunity for you to say, "Let there be light." Let there be light. Y'all stand up with me. Can I tell you that the moment that you turn and look at that enemy that's trying to annoy you, and you say, "Let there be light," that it has no choice but to flee. Light and darkness cannot occupy the same territory. What's so crazy is that you can walk out tonight and there'll be millions and millions and masses of skyline filled with darkness, and one star will penetrate it. You follow me? Don't be afraid to be driven. I'm just telling you. Don't be afraid of the midnight hour. Don't be afraid of the dark. Don't be afraid of the uncertainty. Don't be afraid of being chased. Only be afraid if you never use the words, "Let there be light." Father, bless your people tonight.
You have been listening to the Rejuvenate Church broadcast. If you shared in today's service with us, visit us at www.rejuvenatechurch.com and send us a message. We would love to hear from you. Rejuvenate Church invites you to be our guest if you're in the upstate of South Carolina. We are located in Anderson, South Carolina, inside the Anderson Mall across from Books A Million. Our service times are Sundays at 10:45 a.m. and Wednesdays at 7 p.m. For up-to-date information, visit our website or connect with us on social media. We are found on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram. Pastor Jason Wilson and Rejuvenate Church desire to bridge the gap that divides race, age, and economic status. We are transforming culture by engaging and shaping men and women through relationships and positive kingdom influences. Thank you for listening. We look forward to the opportunity to share with you again at Rejuvenate Church.